Good morning, students. We will continue with the injuries part today. It will be closed globe, concussion or contusion injuries. Now, in blunt trauma to the eye during blunt trauma, there are two mechanisms. One is coup or direct, and secondly, counter coup or distant damage. Now, coup or direct, where the actually the object comes directly into the contact of the globe. For example, corneal abrasion. If it damages the cornea, there will be corneal abrasion. In counter coup, the object has come into contact at one place, but the damage is done to the distant structures of the eye because of the transmitted pressure waves. For example, this is known as counter coup or distant damage. Now here, blunt object has hit the eyeball and the resultant pressure wave has caused edema of the retina in the macula, that is commotio retini. So this is an example of counter coup or distant damage. In some cases, the changes are delayed or progressive. Sometimes it may happen that the injury has happened today, but the damage gets manifested later on, few months back, after few months or after few years. So this can also happen because of the blunt trauma, and so prognosis has to be told guarded in these cases. Example is rosette cataracts. Rosette cataracts can happen immediately. Rosette cataracts can happen later on after the injury has happened. Similarly, initial manifestation may be blood in the anterior chamber, but that may manifest as glaucoma, which is secondary glaucoma may manifest later in the form of angle recession glaucoma. So delayed manifestations of the injury you will have to keep in mind. Now, what is the mechanism of blunt trauma to the eye? Force impinges on the cornea. This tissue is thrust inwards, nicely shown in the diagram, and may be forced against the lens and iris. The wave of aqueous pushes these structures backwards. The compression wave rebounds from the back of the eye, and the lens and iris are thrust forward again. Now, this results into horizontal wave of pressure striking the retina and choroid, as well as the angle of the anterior chamber, and that may do considerable damage. So you will have to understand the transmission of the forces as described just now. Now this may result into delayed complications like secondary glaucoma, cataract, vitreous hemorrhage, retinal detachment, and traumatic iridocyclitis. So if you remember the anatomical sequence of the structures, it will be easy to memorize. So for example, angle damage, secondary glaucoma, then comes lens, cataract, then comes vitreous hemorrhage, then comes retina, retinal detachment, or iridocyclitis. So these are the different manifestations of blunt injury. Now this table nicely enumerates the tissue involved and the manifestations. For example, in the orbit, blood fracture and other, eyelid hematoma, conjunctiva subconjunctival hemorrhage, anterior uvea hyphema and tears of the iris, sphincter and iridodialysis, angle recession and cyclodialysis. In the lens, rosette cataract, subluxation of the lens, rupture of the anterior posterior capsule. In the sclera, rupture, vitreous hemorrhage, choroid, choroidal rupture and suprachoroidal hemorrhage, retina, retinal or subretinal hemorrhage, retinal edema, commotio retini, retinal dialysis, macular edema, and optic nerve, optic nerve avulsion or hemorrhage of the optic nerve sheath. So you will have to remember this and mention, because your long question may have first half of the question enumerate the ophthalmic manifestations of blunt injury. In that you will write this, and then second half of the question may be describe blowout fracture, like that. So for enumeration purpose, you will have to remember this table nicely. Coming to hyphema. hyphema is nothing but blood in the entry chamber. So any injury to the iris, especially angle recession, leads to hemorrhage in the entry chamber, which is known as hyphema. Hyphema commonly reabsorbs rapidly if it fills less than half the entry chamber. If it is more extensive, it clots, leading to pupillary block or trabecular block. In all these cases, there is usually a secondary rise of intraocular pressure in long term as well as other injuries. Admission to the hospital advisable if the hyphema occupies more than half the entry chamber. In that case, patient is observed for 72 to 96 hours because of the danger of secondary hemorrhage. Treatment: affected eye is patched and the patient made to rest with the head elevated. So give patient back rest so that he should be sitting, he or she should be sitting upright, so that with the help of gravity, the blood settles down at the bottom of the entry chamber and helps in the resorption of the blood. If patient lies down, then the blood will spread all over the entry chamber and may occupy the pupillary area, and its absorption becomes problematic. So first thing is give rest to the eye, give propped up position, anti-inflammatory medications locally. Atropine and steroid have no part in the management, but for associated inflammation, some low dose of steroid is also recommended sometimes. But if you put atropine, pupil will be fully dilated and there will be very less surface of iris available for absorption. So rather than putting atropine, one can put homide like drops which will keep pupil mobile, and in that case iritis is also taken care of and iris surface also remains available for absorption of the blood. So topical and systemic glaucoma therapy is used if the intraocular pressure is raised. Aspirin to be avoided, and if pain is unrelieved, threat of blood staining of the cornea, then surgical intervention is needed in the form of aspiration of the entry chamber or paracentesis. This may be accompanied by a glaucoma filtering surgery if intraocular pressure cannot be controlled medically. So in simple words, hyphema, depending on its extent, has only conservative treatment or surgical intervention. Conservative treatment, rest to the eye, propped up position and medications. A surgical intervention, paracentesis or trabeculectomy. Like that you have to manage hyphema. Now effects on the lens of a blunt trauma. There can be dislocation or subluxation. Subluxation, zonules are partially ruptured, lens remains in the pupillary area, there is iridodonesis, phacodonesis, and in dislocation, lens is not in its normal anatomical planes, zonules are ruptured full 360 degree, lens falls into the vitreous or comes into the entry chamber. This is known as dislocation of the IOL. Dislocation of the IOL is emergency because if it falls into the vitreous, rest on the retina, it may do retinal damage leading to detachment. If it comes in the entry chamber, it is emergency. There will be endothelial damage done by the lens which is occupying in the entry chamber, and it may cause secondary glaucoma. So both conditions are dislocation, conditions are emergency, need surgical intervention immediately. Subluxation, depending upon how much subluxation is there, how much aphakic area is there, and how much phakic area is there occupied by the lens, depending on the treatment will depends. So if lot of aphakic area is there, then you will have, and no other complaint, then remove the lens surgically and do scleral fixation. If the phakic area is more, no other symptoms, just watch the case. Depending on that, you will have to operate. Vosseous ring is nothing but a circular ring seen on the entry surface of the lens due to brown amorphous granules of pigment lying on the capsule. Concussion cataract, this is due to mechanical effect and entrance of aqueous through a damaged capsule leading to the affecting the permeability, resulting in the actual tears. One may get cataract. Rosette shaped cataract can be a note for UG. You will have to draw the diagram of rosettes. It is most typical appearance after concussion, usually in the posterior cortex, sometimes in the anterior cortex or both. Star-shaped cortical structures are delineated and feathery lines of opacities outlining the lens fibers radiate from them. Rosette may occasionally disappear, may remain stationary or progress. All possibilities exist to total opacification of the lens, a complication which may appear rapidly within a few hours after the injury or may be delayed. Late rosette cataract may develop in the posterior cortex 1 or 2 years after concussion. Smaller and more compact, its sutural extensions are short. Treatment of cataract, any surgical interference should be delayed for some time, for some months until the final outcome is apparent, because immediate after trauma there may be inflammation. So you are not supposed to operate cataract when inflammation is present. Start anti-inflammatory treatment, wait for few months, ensure that eye is quiet, ensure that there are no other comorbidities, then you operate the cataract and with a good prognosis. Otherwise, you will have to explain to the patient there are other comorbidities like macular edema is there and operate with guarded prognosis. But ensure that inflammation is controlled. In inflammation, if you try to operate the cataract, there is a high risk of endophthalmitis. So don't do that. Posterior capsular integrity should be assessed by ultrasonography so that the type of cataract surgery employed and the intraocular lens to be inserted can be tailored to the eye. Dislocation we already discussed, subluxation also we have already talked about. So these are the nice pictures. First is showing anterior dislocated lens. Lens is occupied total anterior chamber. So major risk is endothelial touch and corneal decompensation, and if the lens occupies the anterior chamber angle, secondary glaucoma. So this is an emergency, you will have to remove the lens immediately. Second picture shows posteriorly dislocated lens. In the pupillary area, one can see the part of the lens which is occupying the posterior segment. And osseous ring is seen in the third picture. Blowout fractures is another important topic, can be asked in the examination. It is due to blunt trauma. Object size is large, and it is blunt, and it is more than the orbital rim, such as a cricket ball, for example. As the orbital opening is blocked by the object, the force is directed at the orbital walls, damaging the thinnest walls of the about the sinuses. So the force transmission goes along the walls. This you will have to mention and remember. And the weakest bones they give way. For example, lamina papyracea of the medial wall. Commonest is medial wall, next common is the floor. Now what happens is, rim is supposed to be intact. So fracture rim doesn't happen, but fracture wall happens. Fracture wall happens in such a way that there is a gaping in the wall. And in this gaping of the wall, muscle entrapment occurs. All these criteria are fulfilled, then you can label this as blowout fracture. Symptoms are pain, tenderness, epistaxis, diplopia. Patient may complain of prominence of the eye on the blowing of his or her nose. On example, initial edema, ecchymosis or emphysema around the adnexa, restriction of the ocular movements, commonly upward or upward. So their movements will be restricted. There will be associated damage to the sinuses. Infraorbital hypostasia is a very important sign, because there will be the damage to the infraorbital nerve. So infraorbital hypostasia will be there. And after the inflammation resolve, patient is left with a relative enophthalmos and restricted ocular motility upwards. When there is everything is inflammatory, you may not be able to really assess the fracture part. So start anti-inflammatory treatment. Once inflammation subsides, then you will notice that there is enophthalmos, eyeball is sunken in. That is an important sign of blowout fracture. And restriction of the movements. Restriction is not neurological, it is a mechanical restriction, which can be tested by force duction test. So traumatic enophthalmos investigation, one will have to go for X-ray, Waters view, or CT orbit. And treatment is surgical release of entrapped muscle, but we will not say immediate. One will have to wait till the edema is reduced, then release of the entrapment of muscle and the trapdoor floor fracture, which is usually seen in children, and patient with non-resolving ocular cardiac reflex. So these are the conditions one will have to remember additional. Generally, the blowout fracture part is sealed by the Teflon meshwork. So release the muscle, and the breach in the continuity of the bone is to be filled by the Teflon meshwork. Here you can see the restricted elevation because of the blowout fracture. Also, you can see enophthalmos in the next figure, and this CT picture is very classic. It is described as tear drop sign, which is seen with the blowout fracture. So surgical approaches, you need not go into the details, just principle of the